to the vent, and you can see how their spectrum change as you turn on this sequence control parameter. So this is the basic form of the research in Hamiltonian, where this psi is our control parameter. That takes us at psi equals zero from a linear molecule to psi equals zero from a two-dimensional molecule. But what we're really interested in, of course, is the steady state one of these transitions. And so this would happen. Basically, we would fit the spectrum of each molecule, and from there, we would be able to discern or assign a value of psi, our control parameter, to that molecule. And that would indicate to us its relative value of rigidness or blockiness, quasi-linear, maybe quasi-linear. So once we've done that, to see the excited state quantum phase transition, we would find a molecule that was in the quasi-linear phase according to its control parameter. And then, so here I decided to use psi equals 0.6, so that to see the excited state quantum phase transition, you just increase in energy until you get to the monotropy point. So at the monotropy point, you can see that the density of states is increasing. It's basically a bunching of these states as you approach the submatrix. And as you pass through it, you end up in the quasi-linear region. So that's why we think this is actually a shape-based transition, that the molecule really is changing from a bent molecule to a linear molecule as you pass through this point. Another way to look at it, more how the molecular physics look at it, is here on the right. So this is just a model potential of bending group. And at the lowest energies, you're in the quasi-bent region. As you increase in energy, you go up towards the barrier in the potential. So that is the monotropy point. And as you pass through it, then you find yourself in a fundamentally different type of potential, so in the quasi-linear region. So if you talk to a molecular physicist, they'll call this monotropy. And we'll talk about the monotropy plot and the monotropy points and everything. But to us, monotropy just is an excited state quantum phase transition. So this is what we want to describe. But of course, we can't just look at the molecule and take a picture of it and see if it's a linear event. So we need to look at the spectroscopic signatures, basically things that we can measure and that we can look for in the spectrum that will indicate to us that this sort of transition is happening within the molecule. So the first thing we look at is the very famous Bergstrom plots. So this is a plot of the difference between difference in energy between neighboring levels as a function of the vibrational quantum number. So on the top left, we see what would happen for a rigidly linear molecule. First, a rigidly linear molecule has a harmonic spectrum, so that's why the energy difference between neighboring levels is constant. For a quasi-linear molecule, the levels actually get further away from each other upon excitation of the vibrational quantum number, so we see a positive slope. Down here, for rigidly bent, the opposite is a negative slope, so the levels are getting closer together. But the most interesting case is here, it's quasi-bent. So we start out with a negative slope, but then we find a definite minimum called the Dixon dip. This Dixon noticed this for the first time in 1864. So after the definite minimum, we do the slope, we continue upwards. Another thing we can look for, I already mentioned briefly, is the monotropy plot. So this is a plot of the energy levels themselves, now as a function of angular momentum quantum number. So for a rigidly linear, we're going to look at the behavior around the origin. We see here it's linear. For quasi-linear, we see a little bit of softening at the lowest levels. For rigidly bent, though, it's changed completely. It's a huge, wide parabola. But then again, the most interesting case here is quasi-bent. It's at the lowest energies, you see the parabola, but then we have a definite change to the more linear behavior. So this, the monotropy plot, are nice to look at least I think so, but if we want to make this a little bit more quantitative, we can actually plot then the energy levels as a function of the exponent on the angular momentum. So this is basically the same thing I said in the last slide, where we're looking at just the exponent of the angular momentum, which we call the LLVP. So for rigidly linear, the overall behavior we're looking for is linear as a function of angular momentum. So that means that our gamma VD will be zero for the entire spectrum. For quasi-linear, there was a little bit of a difference in the lowest energy, so you see this little tail here. But mostly it's still just zero. For rigidly bent, we had parabolic behavior, so we have a value of 1 for gamma VD. And again, the most interesting case is quasi-bent, where we start out with a value of 1 and we drop quickly down to 0. So we can see that change happening in this type of plot. The last thing I want to mention before the actual application. patients is the potential energy services and how they change as we move again from rigidly linear up here, rigidly banked spin penalty, quasi-linear, and then quasi-banked. You can see just the small barrier in the potential. Okay, so what did we actually do? We found a series of 10 molecules. We fed all of the experimental data that we could find using our Hamiltonian, and we were able to, this is a critical point for our control parameter psi. So I'm going to the left, it's quasi-linear, and I'm going to the right, it's quasi-bent. And using our Hamiltonian parameters that we got out, we were able to give definite assignments on the values of the control parameter to each molecule. So this was interesting. We had a whole spectrum of molecules ranging basically